Well, it's time for game two of this doubleheader matchup between Rochester and Susquehanna. Again, this is the second game of today's action in the D3 showcase here at Atrium Health Ballpark. Welcome in to today's broadcast. Dan Halody joined by Matt Millward, our general manager here for the Kannapolis Cannonballers. Myself, Dan Halody, the broadcaster, media relations coordinator for the Cannonballers. Pleasure to have you join us tonight here on YouTube as we bring you the action in tonight's D3 baseball here in Kannapolis.
Let's have some fun tonight.
Rochester will get the start tonight in the field. Matt Millward joining as well here. Matt, we had a great game last night, a great first game, but Susquehanna and Rochester playing under the lights.
Yeah, can't get any better Friday night in Kannapolis.
Beautiful night, beautiful weather indeed. Looking at about
it's a little chilly.
It's a little chilly, about 52 degrees. Clear skies, though. Wind is about 6 miles an hour in from the northwest. Clear at the moment and calm at the moment. However, we are going to hopefully find ourselves with a nice night of baseball here in Kannapolis. On the bump for Rochester to start tonight's action is going to be Nolan Sparks, the righty. 5'10" senior from Aurora, Colorado, went to Cherokee Trail High School, and he is now with the Rochester Yellow Jackets and will join us here for tonight's game.
Dan, you got to read off his stat line from last year.
His stat line from last year is
these numbers are
sensational.
Impressive.
I think you've already researched it. Go ahead.
No, I just wrote stat line.
You're the color commentator. You didn't prepare for the color commentary, Matt Millward, of course. So 11 starts on the mound last year. He had a pretty solid year. 7-0 record, a 2.76 ERA. He did have a little bit higher of a whip in 62 innings, but 7-0 record, you can't beat that at all.
As Liberty Sean League Pitcher of the Year last year.
He's pretty solid. Sean McCullough waves at the first pitch of this game. We are underway here at 7:33 p.m. here on the East Coast in Kannapolis. Sean McCullough leads things off for Susquehanna. It'll be Dylan Hayduke and Tony Rossi to follow for the Riverhawks as the 0-1 is a bit up and away. Count is 1-1.
Like, agree with me, Nolan Sparks is just like such a pitcher name, too.
It's such a pitcher name, such a baseball name. As McCullough at the plate for the Riverhawks. 1-1 on the way. Fastball outside corner for a called strike. It's 1-2.
All right, let's start it off right from the get-go. So we've got the Riverhawks. Do you know what the Riverhawks name is, the mascot?
I do not.
Benny.
Benny the Riverhawk. As it's a 1-2 count, definitely taking his time on the bump is Nolan Sparks. And a senior from Cherokee Trail High School has now time. And it's going to be a 2-2 count as he took a little too long on the mound. Again, a non-traditional pitch clock being used here at this level of Division III baseball. 2-2 count. Sparks working from the stretch. Here's the pitch. Fastball up and away. Count now full. Getting Dylan Hayduke, the second batter in the order, waiting on deck.
First game of the year for Rochester, coming in with a perfect 0-0 record.
Looking to start the year off on a high note. 3-2, full count offering up. Is a low one inside for ball four. And McCullough will draw the free pass to start off tonight's game. Dylan Hayduke will now get a chance to bat with one on, nobody out. Battle of two sides, Matt, that have some pretty clean uniforms. I'm really liking the looks for both of these sides tonight. Rochester going with a little bit of an off-white look with the blue caps and the yellow R on the front of the cap. But the Riverhawks showing out as well.
The Riverhawks are giving me very San Francisco Giant vibes.
I can see the Giants. I was talking with our groundskeeper, Tim Siegel. He thought initially Florida State. I said, no, different ACC school, Virginia Tech.
Yeah.
Is what I was looking at with the colors. 1-0 on the way from Sparks. Is on the outside corner. It's 1-1.
So the Riverhawks coming at 1-1. Split their first series with Mary Washington.
They're going to get back in the win column against Rochester, who probably are working. Come on, probably have a couple more things to iron out tonight. Just getting your feet back under you, playing baseball. Pitch fouled off by Hayduk. And that first game is always the one that you got to kind of get your feet wet a little bit. You get back in action, especially if you have freshmen that are new to this level of baseball. It's a 1-2 count on Hayduk, playing second base today for Susquehanna. Sparks working exclusively from the stretch. He sets with a red glove at the belly. 1-2 outside of the plate. Throw to second and the runner going is not in time. Throw is a little high. It is a stolen base for Sean McCullough. So now let's make it a runner in scoring position with a 2-2 count for Dylan Hayduk.
Susquehanna's second appearance in our D3 showcase. Last year they went 2-1.
Rochester appearing last year as well, and they showed up and showed out. Hayduk fouls it off.
Yeah, they split their one of their games got rained out, unfortunately, but they did split last year. They fell short to Christopher Newport 8-7, but came back with a big win the following day against Marietta 4-1.
And Marietta always seems to be in the mix, in the hunt. Rochester able to get a gritty win. 2-2 in there. Ring him up. Got him looking called. Strike three. Dylan Hayduk is a victim of a punch out as Nolan Sparks picks up his first of the evening. A backwards K in the scorebook. That'll set things up for Tony Rossi with one on and one out.
So we quickly talked about Susquehanna's 1-1 start, but Tony Rossi beasted out that first homestand. 5 RBIs he had and was player of the week.
Sparks' first pitch is a bit low and outside. Count is 1-0. Yeah, actually, the roster that we picked up from Susquehanna didn't have Tony Rossi on it. We're at number 32 for the Riverhawks, and he's nowhere to be found on the roster, so I had to go deep dive in and check and make sure he was actually a thing, and of course he is. First pitch, fastball was a ball. Second pitch, also a fastball, and that's a strike. It's even at 1-1. Rossi, 6'5", from Doylestown, Pennsylvania.
Big kid.
1-1 count with one out. Sparks will set, takes a peek at second. Pitch delivered, low and outside. It's 2-1.
He definitely looks like he could poke one out, especially out to left field tonight. Wind was blowing in, blowing out for a little bit, but I think it's the first time in the last 3 days the wind's actually been calm.
Yeah, of course, being 6'5 as well, you're going to have a little bit of bigger of a strike zone to manage. 2-1 in the way. This one's lifted into right field. That's going to fall in front of the right fielder and be a base knock. Rounding third at home, there's going to be a play at the plate. It's in time. There's going to be a little bit of dancing. Now a pickle, and they tag the lead runner. Headed to second is Rossi, so it's going to be a single in the book. And then he advances to second on the throw, but McCullough is nailed in between third and home. It ended up being a bit of a pickoff as he immediately kind of ended up running back up the baseline back towards third. He knew he was going to be out by a mile. But the play at the plate and the catcher, Siciliano, makes the play. So Lance Book will stand in with now Rossi at second and two down.
Great throw.
So a 9-2 put out of McCullough. And we remain scoreless in this top of the first. First pitch hacked at a missed by Lance Book. Excuse me, Jack Cahill at the plate. Jack Cahill, the left fielder. Warrior number 25, Lance Books on deck. Warrior number 7. Cahill, the left fielder, pitch on the way. Swing and a miss. As Cahill, another big body at 6'4". So a couple of large men in the lineup for Susquehanna.
Something special about night games here. Love it. Under the lights. First night game at Atrium Health Ballpark this year, so
There just always is a special vibe about it. 0-2 up and inside. 1-2 on Lance, Jack Cahill. And night game's always special. The lighting here is absolutely unique. I've been to a lot of ballparks and a lot of night games because I don't like day games, in all honesty. Day games are always too hot. 1-2. Swing and a miss at the plate. Another punch out for Sparks. He picks up a big hack and a miss from Cahill, and that sends it to the end of the top of the first inning. Bottom one we go after a quick break as Susquehanna tries to get some offense going. Instead, they are thwarted. So Rochester will bat in the bottom of the first when we come back here in the Game 3 of the D3 Showcase in Kannapolis.
Welcome back to the Cannon Ballers Radio Network. Scoreless first half. As we head to the bottom of the first. Ryan Redman on the mound for the Redhawks. A little high there for ball one. Leading off for the Yellow Jackets, number 8, Ethan Jaquet. Redman delivers. Right back to him. Good stab. And he'll underhand for the first baseman for out number one. That'll bring up the shortstop, number 7, Jackson Reed. Little bit outside for ball one. So as we mentioned, winds have finally calmed down here in Kannapolis, North Carolina. We had gusty winds the last 2 to 3 days. Flies that one out to right. For out number 2. Thank you. That'll bring up number 13, Sammy Bestry. First pitch is a little high. Delivers a little inside, ball number two. Saved the day, Dan. We now have a radar gun. So here in Kannapolis, we were having some issues with our TrackMan system. And our radio announcer, Dan Helody, saved the day.
It's what I am here to do. One count, and the pitch on the way from Redmond to Bestry. It's just a bit outside. 3-1.
Yeah, Dan, you make this a lot more natural than I do.
Three, one count. Pitch on the way. So we're going to tap her towards the third baseman. It lands foul. A cannon of an arm from third baseman. In Rossi, it was just foul though. So a full count on Bestry for the Rochester Yellow Jackets. Division III in the Liberty League.
2023 regular season champions. 28-14 record last year.
Not too shabby. 3-2 inside from all four. So first base runner of the night for Rochester, and it is a walk to Bestry. So now Josh Leadham will get a chance to bat. So Leadham stands in with Bestry at first.
All right, Dan, so we talked about Benny the Riverhawk. Do you know what the Yellow Jackets' name is?
I'm going to take a guess with this one. I'm going to go Yeller the Yellow Jacket. Not even
not.
Close, is it?
Rocky.
Rocky. I can get behind that.
Yeah.
That's cool. I can get behind that. Well, Yeller the Yellow Jacket, that'd be funny. No, Rocky. That's cool.
I'm sure there's a story behind that.
Oh, yeah. Even if it's simple as Rocky is just like a abbreviation for Rochester.
Oh, that yeah, that would be the obvious.
Even if it's a simple story, it's probably a good one. Runner fakes going to take, but it's a called strike on Leadham. So a 1-1 count. Bottom of the first inning, still scoreless. One hit for Susquehanna, and none yet for Rochester. 1-1 on the way. Fastball inside corner. Ryan Redmond on the mound, 6'4", 190-pound junior, a physics and engineering major at Susquehanna. Appeared in 13 games last year, started 5, 1-1 on the mound. As Leadham lifts this one into left center field on the 1-2. That one will drop in the warning track and roll to the wall and be trouble. Rounding third at home is Bestry. Headed to third is Leadham. He's on his horse. Play at third. And he's in there safely standing up. It's an RBI triple for Rochester and Josh Leadham. And that'll hand the Yellow Jackets the first run of the ball game. It's an RBI triple from Rochester's right fielder. So a two-out RBI triple hands Rochester a early lead. And that'll send it to Henry Jameson. The runner on third and two down. First pitch to Jameson. A breaking ball hacked at a missed 0-1. Henry Jameson stands in. graduate student from St. Simons Island, Georgia. A one. This one's lifted into left center field. This one is a hit right to Jack Cahill, who comes over to make the grab for the out, a fly out into left. But damage done as Rochester picks up the first run of this ball game. An RBI triple from Josh Leadham. That'll send us into the second inning. When we come back here on the D3 Showcase Radio Network here on YouTube. Ballers here in Kannapolis. It's Rochester and Susquehanna.
And we're back here on the D3 Showcase Radio Network. Heading to the top of the second. University of Rochester on the board first with one in the bottom half. Lance Book leads off here for the Riverhawks, and that one's a little low. Sparks delivers. One's grounded to second. Should be an easy play. Over to first. Got him in time. Score that 1-4-3. That'll bring up our right fielder, number 31, Michael Mancuso. Mancuso out of Hawthorne, New York. Swings and misses for strike one. Went to Central Bucks East, also known to others as CB East. That one's inside. Levels the count at 1-1. Sparks gets his sign and delivers. Swing and a miss for strike number two. It's a rather chilly, balmy night here. Low 50s, but temperature keeps dropping. Tomorrow's supposed to be a beautiful day, though. Should get back up here in the 60s. We'll see some more doubleheader action tomorrow. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Two outs on the board. And that'll bring up our DH, number 54, Thomas Romanelli. So we'll pick up action tomorrow. Kickoff at 1 p.m. Riverhawks will face Berry College out of Georgia. Check swing. Call for strike number one. And for our Yellow Jackets fans out there, tomorrow's game 4:30. We'll be facing off against the Washington and Lee Generals, who fell short tonight 7-4 in game number one. Told Washington and Lee will be throwing their quote-unquote ace tomorrow. Sparks delivers. Swing and a miss for strike two. Romanelli in an early hole here, 0-2. We'll see what Sparks has in his arsenal here. Maybe something off speed. Gets a sign and delivers. That one looks like it's going to sneak out of play into our picnic area. Count remains 0-2. 93-mile-per-hour fastball on that last pitch. Tried to gas it right by him. Sparks on the 0-2 pitch. Got him. Swinging strike number three. So 1-2-3 inning. Two strikeouts. And that'll retire the side. So as we head to the bottom of the second, Yellow Jackets one, River Hawks none. We'll be back here on the Cannonballers Radio Network.
We got it. It needed to be in data capture mode. We got a 4-3, a K, and a 4-3 and 2Ks. Official score is paying a lot of attention to this game. A lot of attention to this game. Welcome back into bottom of the second inning between Susquehanna and Rochester as these two sides battle. Appreciate you tuning in and hanging out with us here as Dan Lodi here alongside Ballers General Manager Matt Millward. Of course, I had to do a little duties as a side as, oh my goodness, this one
there
is crushed. And it is a solo shot. Alexander Gonzalo with a solo blast to start at the bottom of the second inning, and it makes it now 2-0 Rochester in this bottom of the second. Gonzalo with his first homer of the year, and it doubles the lead for the Yellow Jackets.
He just got that ball up there, and it carried. Seems like the air is just, I don't know, just dry tonight where this ball's going to carry.
86-mile-an-hour ball right in the middle, right about chest high, and he turned on it and sent it into the left field berm for a souvenir. So now Dan Tirabassi will step in. First pitch lifted high and foul down the first baseline. It'll be an 0-1 count. As Ryan Redman now has allowed two quick runs through not even two innings of work, allowing an RBI triple from Josh Leadham and an Alexander Gonzalo solo blast. 0-1, breaking ball spun in for a strike, 0-2. We got the radar gun working. after it was working in the first, and then it stopped working, and then I went back over in that top of the second. That's why you had Mr. Millward flying solo as the 0-2 lifted into right. Under it out there is the right fielder in Manuso for the catch and the out. One down, and now Dylan Stezzi will stand in. Mancuso with the snag out in right, and now Stezzi will stand in. Of course, if you're watching on YouTube, be sure you send us some questions. Hang out with us. Appreciate you tuning in and joining us here as Stezzi hacks at the first pitch and misses 0-1.
So I have to say the University of Rochester is probably the luckiest golf team in the country.
Hmm. Luckiest golf team in the country.
So their home course, Oak Hill Country Club.
Oh.
If you're a golf fan, most people are familiar with Oak Hill.
Just a casual.
The East course, so is a Donald Ross design. But their golf team gets to play on this amazing course. So it's hosted U.S. Opens the last 10 years. So every 10 years they've been hosting the PGA Championship and actually the host of the 1995 Ryder Cup.
Hmm. Yeah, a lot of golf up there. 1-2. This one's grounded to second underhand. Flip for the out of 4-3. Ground out. Stezzi is retired. Man, that's some good golf.
To have that as your like home course and get to play there? All right, trivia question.
Uh-oh.
2023 PGA Championship winner was who? This was at Oak Hill last year.
Oh, this is going to... You're asking the wrong guy. I don't keep up with golf.
Brooks Koepka.
Koepka. Isn't he like the trash talker of the tour? I don't keep up with the PGA enough. I should.
Well, he is actually a LIV golfer now.
Mm. Shows you how much I keep up with it. Pitch grounded back up the middle, stabbed by Redmond. He flips underhand to first for the out just like that. It is a quick rebound from Ryan Redmond after allowing a solo homer. Picks up three quick outs, and it'll send us into the third inning. We'll take a quick break and be right back here on YouTube as Rochester and Susquehanna battle it out. 2-0 Yellow Jackets at Atrium Health Ballpark. .891 due up in the order for the Susquehanna Riverhawks. Top of the third inning, 2-0 Rochester here in Kannapolis. So the D3 showcase, first pitch of the third inning from Nolan Sparks is in there for a called strike, 0-1. As Chris Orego, the catcher, leads things off in his first at-bat of the night. It'll be, again, 8-9-1. Michael Busso and Sean McCulloch to follow. 1 from Sparks, tap towards short. Easily played, set his feet, throw to first in time for the out. And just like that, a one quick out, a 6-3 grounder. Now Michael Busso, shortstop, will stand in.
So, Dan, do you know what the longest river on the East Coast is?
Longest river on the East Coast, Susquehanna River.
You are correct.
How would I ever guess that?
444 miles long. So, obviously, the university sits right on the Susquehanna River. So, do you, another crazy stat, baseball related. Do you know where the Susquehanna River starts?
That's a good question. I don't.
Cooperstown, New York.
Cooperstown. What a great spot.
And then it flows all the way down to the Chesapeake Bay.
Cooperstown, what a town. Oh, one on the way. This
have you ever been to Cooperstown?
I have. Tap towards third. Easily played. To his left makes the play for the out. Two down now, and that'll lead it off. Send things to the leadoff batter, Sean McCullough. Yeah, Cooperstown, for those of you who have never been to Cooperstown, it is a baseball town.
Oh, I would hope so.
Everything is baseball. There are just shops upon shops upon baseball this, baseball that.
When was the last time you were there?
2015. 2015, when I went up to see my grandfather pitch in there for a called strike to McCullough. Actually, went up with family. My grandpa was staying with my aunt, who lives in Oneonta, New York, about 40 minutes outside of Cooperstown. And I begged and begged and begged. I said, can we please go up to Cooperstown? And my parents were like, no, no, we can't. We can't do it this trip. 0-1 outside, 1-1. Until finally my great aunt looked at my mom, and she goes, get in the car. We're going to Cooperstown. We spent the whole afternoon up there. And I took...
So you got the call to Cooperstown.
So many great things to see up there. 1-1 hacked at a miss, 1-2 on McCullough.
Have you ever been over the Chesapeake Bay Bridge?
Yes. It's been a long time.
Beautiful bridge.
Beautiful bridge.
So you've been the entire length of the Susquehanna then?
Yeah. It's been a while. Need to get back up there. 1-2 count. Sparks sets on the bump. Pitch delivered. Swing and a miss at the plate. Another punch out for Sparks. How about now four on his night? Excuse me, five as McCullough sits down. It is the first time he's sat down tonight. A 1-2-3 inning on the bump for Sparks. That'll send us into the bottom of the third inning. Rochester will send the top of the order to the plate when we come back here in Kannapolis. Top of the order, due up for Rochester. Ethan Hockett will step in as the Yellow Jackets up 2-0 on the Susquehanna Riverhawks as Hockett fouls one off of that beautiful Atrium Health ballpark sign on the first base side. Better be thankful he didn't break it. That sign has been through it up there. A lot of foul balls. Pitch on the way from Redmond. Breaking ball is in there, called strike.
Tell you what, if you're a kid at this game, there's no way you're not walking home with a foul ball tonight.
Oh, not at all. Not at all. There's been some at-bats tonight that have produced some souvenirs. 0-2. Low one outside. Nice grab.
Although for how chilly it is, great crowd. I would say there's a couple hundred sitting behind the plate here.
Definitely a nice crowd. It's not too chilly. The wind is definitely helping, and there's none of it. 1-2. Inside corner, ring him up, got him looking, called strike three. Redmond picks up his punch out, his first one of the night. Hockett takes a peek at it, so one out, and now Jackson Reed will stand in.
So as mentioned, Rochester comes in first game of the year. Perfect line, 0-0. But so from Kannapolis, they'll go back home for a week and come right back to the Carolinas, believe it or not. So they'll be in the Triad Invitational, which is in Greensboro. So they'll have a three-game weekend set against Maryville College, Adrian College, and Greensboro College.
Just up the road.
And then, believe it or not, they stay here and go to Cary then. Cary, North Carolina, home of USA Baseball.
Oh, yeah. 1-0. Shows bunt, pulls it back, doesn't matter. Called strike, 1-1 on Reed.
But they'll head to Cary and do double headers back-to-back days.
Ooh.
Against William Peace University. Hmm. And then it won't be till March 17th for their home opener against St. John Fisher.
As this one's roped in on the 1-1 to right center. Quickly dropping, laying out as a center fielder. But he won't get there. It'll fall in for a single. Jackson Reed is in there safely with a nice hit single in the gap in right center. McCullough laid out for it, but he couldn't get there. So it's one on and one out now for Sammy Bestry, the second baseman.
Reed put that in the best spot he could out there.
Couldn't have pinpointed that one better. Pretty cool that Rochester gets to stay down in the Carolinas and see a couple of cool complexes. Have you ever been to Cary head to the USA
beautiful.
Complex?
It's beautiful.
Fascinating.
So in here in Kannapolis, we're lucky enough to host USA Baseball once a year.
This one's roped into right. Back-to-back base knocks for the Yellow Jackets. Two singles as Bestry now on for the second time tonight. He reached before on a walk, and now he has a base hit. So that'll turn things to Josh Leadham, who's got an RBI triple already tonight.
Now, pregame, I was talking to Denny Bowers, head coach of Susquehanna, and he was telling me last weekend their series against Mary Washington. It was beautiful out, 40 degrees and about 20-mile-per-hour winds.
Oh. That is football weather. Pitch a bit outside, 1-0 count. Yeah, 40 degrees at 20-mile-an-hour winds. That's what you call football weather.
Wear your batting gloves.
Yeah. 1-0 count. Leadham looking to add to his already productive night. Pitch fouled off on the 1-0.
Yeah, triple in the first.
RBI base knock to score a Bestry.
And he definitely legged that out. Where he hit that, it's doubles territory, and usually not triples, but.
Showed off a little bit of the speed, did Josh Leadham. Oh. Redmond fakes it now. We got a pickle. In between second and third, Redmond's going to throw to the shortstop now. Back, and we got ourselves a pickle still. No tag yet. Dancing around, they finally get him. Runner does move to second, though, as that's going to be a pickoff. And I'm gonna have to take a second and look and see how they did it. So Bestry got to second for sure.
1-4-6-4, I believe.
1-4-6-4, indeed. So two outs, runner on second now. And the 1-1 count remains. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss. 1-2 your count. Breaking ball caught Leadham off guard.
Yeah, I think it could be a tough night for the Riverhawks. Sparks on the mound for the Jackets. He looks sharp so far. There's a reason he was 7-0 last year.
Oh, just a bit outside. 2-2. Sitting in the mid-80s or so is Redmond.
Another baseball name, Redmond.
Redmond. I think of Mike Redmond, the old manager for the Marlins. About 10 years ago, probably. 2-2. Check swing. Doesn't matter. Ring him up. Got him looking. Called strike three. It's another punch out for Ryan Redman. Josh Leadham takes a peek. Strike three. That's the third out. And we are now one third of the way home here in Kannapolis. Top of the fourth. Rochester up 2-0. We'll be right back here in Kannapolis at Atrium Health Ballpark. It's game three of seven in the D3 showcase. Well, Dylan Hayduke will lead it off top of the fourth inning here at Atrium Health Ballpark. His back on the mound is Nolan Sparks. As Matt Millward, our general manager, has departed for the time being. We've got a new color commentator on the microphone to my right. It's Walker Brook. I can't keep up with your title. What's your new title now?
Ticket sales manager.
Gotcha.
Been around the block a few times here.
Well, You've been promoted so many times, it's hard to keep up. 0-1, grounded towards the second baseman, moves to his left, makes the play for the out. And just like that, a 4-3 ground out for Dylan Hayduke. Tony Rossi will now stand in. So Walker Brook, our ticket sales manager, taking over color commentary duties. And we'll let him just sit here and have some fun here as Rochester and Susquehanna battle it out in game three of seven this weekend of Division III baseball. Pitch delivered by Sparks, a bit low and outside. It is a 1-0 count. Again, appreciate you tuning in and joining us on YouTube. We'll take a peek and check to see if y'all sent any questions in as this one's laced into center. That'll drop for a base knock. And that'll be another base hit for Tony Rossi. He picks up his second of the night, a multi-hit game, so one on, one out. And Jack Cahill will stand in. One question. Jason asks, how hard are they throwing? They're throwing about lower 90s, honestly. Lower 90s, upper 80s. Off speed in the upper 70s. Done some good stuff so far. Jack Cahill will get a turn at the plate. Struck out his first time up. First pitch on the way. Low one outside. Count is 1-0. Jack Cahill, 0-for-1 today. As Rossi's at first. Pitch delivered. Low and outside from Sparks. Count is 1-0. So Nolan Sparks sets on the mound. We'll take a peek. Here's a pitch. Tapped foul. 1-1 your count. Jack Cahill. On deck is Lance Book for Susquehanna.
Is it 2-1?
Pitch delivered on the 2-1. A bit upstairs. Now 3-1. About 90 miles an hour with that fastball. Again, Rossi at first with a multi-hit game. 3-1 count. Cahill trying to avoid the ground ball. Pitch delivered. Up and in. Sotomayor hits him in the head. And it'll be a free pass issued. So the second will go Rossi, and Cahill will take the free pass. Another walk issued by Nolan Sparks. So Lance Book will stand in.
Looks like we got a visit to the mound here.
So now Todd called, and we'll see a mound visit. Lance Book will stand in. Book, his last time up, grounded out to the second baseman in Bestry. Top of the fourth inning here, one down. Second game of two today. It's two sides battling. Rochester's first game of the season. Sparks sets, pitch delivered. In there, called strike.
Weekend of double headers here. Tonight, tomorrow, and Sunday, I believe.
Yep, all double headers. Tomorrow, two games. In the 1 o'clock hour and the 4 o'clock hour. And then two games on Sunday, 9:30 a.m. and then 1 o'clock. 0-1 lifted high and foul. Count is 0-2. I got to consult whoever gave the idea of the 9:30 a.m. start. There's a saying in the Helody household, of course, my household. Anything before 10 a.m. is of the devil. That's why even our education day games are at 11 o'clock. Yeah. Here in Kannapolis. 0-2 pitch. Tapped, foul. Count will remain 0-2.
So, Dan, you've been with the team a couple of seasons now. What you worked over at the old stadium, is that correct?
Yeah, so my first season with the Kannapolis Baseball Club, it was 2019, back when they were still the Intimidators. I worked the final season there. 2020, obviously, there was no baseball. And then 2021, we moved to this beautiful facility, and I've been here every year of it. As the 0-2 has been outside, runners going. No throw over to third. It was not in time, so a stolen base for Rossi. And then Cahill follows up on it as well. So Lance Book now with two runners in scoring position. Sparks will set on the bump. Pitch delivered. Lifted high and foul. Count will stay 2-2.
Really working the count here.
Yeah, I think I was calculating it a couple of weeks ago. Of the over 300 Cannonballers games that have been played in this ballpark, I think I've missed 8 of them. That's it.
Well, it's pretty impressive.
2-2, lifted high and foul.
Is it really up to 300 at this point?
Something like that, yeah. I mean, we play 66 home games a year. We've been here for 3 seasons. Somewhere in there. I mean, maybe it's closer to 200. But I'm also counting the games I've been on the road.
Gotcha.
Okay. So, numbers are getting up there. 2-2 count on Lance Book. Here's the pitch. Up and in. Count now runs full. Count is actually 2-2. We had a error with the scoreboard up here. 2-2 count. One out. Sparks sets. He's in a bit of a pickle. Pitch delivered. Low, went outside. Blocked. Count will run full.
Got a big spot here for Susquehanna?
Yeah, you have an open base, so a walk here wouldn't necessarily be the worst thing in the world. A walk wouldn't be the worst thing in the world. You have the open base at first. However, you don't want to put any extra on. 3-2. Swing and a miss at the plate. He struck him out. There's a punch out for Sparks as Lance Book goes after a fastball upstairs. Two down now. And a Michael Mancuso is going to stand in. Michael Mancuso gets an opportunity with two on and two out. Pitch delivered. Up and in. 1-0 count on Mancuso. His first time up and a strikeout swinging against Nolan Sparks. Pitch delivered. Low and inside. Count is 2-0. Runner on third is Rossi. And at second is Cahill. 2-0. Ooh, up and in. Hits him in the head. It'll be a hit-by-pitch. As Mancuso's going to get the free walk to first. As the HBP, he got hit in the coconut. Looks like he's okay. The batting helmet does its job.
'll see if Susquehanna can push across a run here and manufacture something after being pretty quiet the first couple innings of this ball game.
So Thomas Romanelli will get a chance to bat in this top of the fourth with bases chuck full of Riverhawks. Sparks sets on the mound, pitch delivered. In there for a called strike, 89-mile-an-hour fastball. Thomas Romanelli struck out his first time up. Looking to change his fates here in this one. 0-1 from Sparks. He grounded sharply past the first baseman, in through to right for a base hit, and that's going to be trouble. Scoring is Rossi. Scoring is Cahill. Here comes the third runner in Mancuso. Throw into the infield. Throw will go to third. Sliding in safely, though, is Romanelli. It's a bases-clearing RBI triple, and Susquehanna has quickly taken the lead. It's 3-2 here in Kannapolis. Rossi, Cahill, and Mancuso all score. And Romanelli with an RBI triple on a ball down the line and right that the first baseman in Tirabassi couldn't get to easily. And then the right fielder, Leadham, misplayed it. And all three runners cross to make it 3-2 Riverhawks. First pitch to Orego. He's a bit outside, a 1-0 count.
Bringing some life to that visitor's dugout over there.
Now, time call. The home plate umpire says, hey, Susquehanna, calm down a little bit. One-oh count on Chris Orego. His first time up, he grounded out to the shortstop. Pitch on the way, low and outside, 2-0.
So you mentioned being around a couple of times, you know, whether it be here at the new stadium or the old stadium just down the road. Do you have a favorite memory from that old place in the final season?
Ooh, favorite memory from the old stadium. 2-0 in there, called strike, 2-1 on Orego. I'd say my favorite memory from the old stadium, I think there's three. There's three key days that you can't ever forget. And it was My first ever game, which was opening day. 2-1 in the way line, grounded sharply to first. Kipton in front of him, going to be a tough play. Underhand, and can't cover at first is Sparks. Reaching first will be Orego on an infield single. It's not really a misplay. He played it and made an effort. He just beat out the throw. So it's an infield single, and scoring is Romanelli. So now 4-2 Susquehanna here in the top of the fourth inning. Michael Busso will step in as the eighth batter of the inning.
Ooh, two-out rally going here.
So Busso gets another turn. Sparks' pitch. Wave and a miss. 0-1. Yeah, three key days, I would say. I'd say opening day. I would say 4th of July. That was very special. And then the final game. Last ever game in that ballpark. Was quite a night. Pitch hacked and a missed by Busso, 0-2. I was at the last game of that ballpark, and I was here for the first game. And the difference between the two is just so strong. The entire vibe of Kannapolis baseball changed with the new ballpark here. Pitch of it outside, 1-2. On to Michael Busso. One, two on Busso. Two outs, top of the fourth. Susquehanna up 4-2 over the Rochester Yellow Jackets. 1-2 pitch, runner going, swing and a foul tip into the mid of the catcher, so that'll be strike three. Throw doesn't matter as it is a strikeout of the plate. So Busso is going to be the third out. That's a strikeout, and that will conclude the top of the fourth inning. So that'll send us to the bottom of the fourth. We'll take a quick break and be right back here on the Ballers YouTube network. And the D3 is showcase action. Susquehanna with a four-run top of the fourth puts them on top 4-2. Bottom of the fourth, it's Henry Jameson leading off. He lays a bunt down. Catcher makes the play. Throw to first. Did they get him? Yes, they did. A nice play by the catcher, Chris Orego. And just like that, Jameson is retired. So the first out is had at this bottom of the fourth inning. That'll send things to Alexander Gonzalo, who had the solo shot in the second inning. Pitch delivered by Ryan Redmond. It is just a bit outside on the corner for a called strike, 0-1. 0-1 on the way. Just a bit low in the dirt, 1-1. Gonzalo, again, a solo shot in the second inning that gave Rochester a little bit of life.
Yeah, I wish we had had the trackman up and working there. I think that thing
was... Yeah, could have seen the...
velo and...
exit velocity and the distance traveled. That would have been wild. 1-1. Emergency swing. He fouls it off. It's 1-2.
It's kind of hard to tell from here in our perspective in the press box, but do you know how far that happened to go up the hill there in the berm in left field?
So the power alley is 388. In the corner, the line, I should say, as this one's fouled off, 1-2. Down the line and left, it's 325. So it progressively goes from 325 to 388 in the power alley. So where it was hit, you're looking at it probably at least 370 to get it out of the field of play. So you're looking at what was probably a 385, 390-foot shot as Gonzalo swings and misses for strike three. So two outs now. Dan Tirabassi is going to step in. You're looking at probably a 385, 390-foot shot off the bat of Gonzalo. Because where it was hit, I would guess probably 370-ish to get it over that wall and left near the berm.
We've definitely had our fair share of longer home runs here at this ballpark.
We've had some tattoos go over that fence as that one's a ball outside from Redmond to Tirabassi. 1-0 on the way. Just a bit low and outside.
I think I remember one this past season where he put it up into the construction site over in right field or something like that.
Yeah, balls. I remember that one. I remember who hit it, but 2-0 check swing. He goes around, so it's 2-1. Still the hardest hit ball I've ever seen in this ballpark was actually not in an actual game. It was in batting practice, but it's kind of stupid how far that ball went. 2-1, this one's in the dirt. So 3-1 on Tirabassi. Now the number two prospect in baseball in Jackson Chorio with the Carolina Mudcats hit a ball over the scoreboard out onto Laureate Way in Kannapolis. Talk about a work of power. Because you're looking at 370-ish to get it over the wall. And then probably, I don't know, 50 feet of berm, you'd think. Mm-hmm. And then a whole concourse. And then the scoreboard. As Redmond gets the strikeout call there. And Tirabassi's down on strikes. It's a quick 1-2-3 frame on the mound for Redmond. A nice little rebound, and Susquehanna has the momentum. They're up 4-2 here after four innings of work. Top of the fifth we go. We'll be right back on the Ballers YouTube network. Susquehanna and Rochester, 4-2, your score. Well, there's a new arm on the bump for the Rochester Yellow Jackets. It's Matt Casiro on the bump as he takes over here for Rochester in this fifth inning. A junior from Cedar Knolls, New Jersey, as he'll face off against the top of the order for Susquehanna, Sean McCulloch, back to step in. First pitch, and they're called strike. It's 0-1 on McCulloch. Matt Casiro, product of Del Barton High School in New Jersey. A one on the way. Lifted high and foul, and it'll be 0-2.
See if those kids run over there and pick up that foul ball.
And McCullough, Hayduke, and Rossi. As Nolan Sparks goes four innings, five hits, four runs, all earned, a walk, and seven strikeouts. As the 0-2 up and away, 1-2. Pitch on the way from Casiro. Lifted into center, but it is hit right to Hockett for the out. It'll be an F8 in the scorebook. One down and due up is Dylan Hayduke. So Hayduke will get another turn. He's 0-2 with a strikeout and a ground out in tonight's action. Pitch on the way from the lefty. Just a bit outside. It's a 1-0 count. Susquehanna up 4-2 after a four-run top of the fourth. Rochester had jumped out initially. However, the Riverhawks putting a little bit of effort into the offense. Pitch in there, called strike, 1-1. So if results hold, regardless of whatever else, if results hold and Susquehanna does take the victory, this one's outside 2-1, and the lead doesn't change, Sparks would be in line for the loss. Two-one on the way. Fastball upstairs, but a called strike. 2-2. Two-two count, one out. Tony Rossi waiting on deck. Here's the pitch. Oh, and outside. Count runs full.
Fans starting to bundle up out there. Temperature is dropping here in Kannapolis.
Getting a little chilly. It's supposed to be even colder this weekend. It's Hayduke lifts this one high and foul. Supposed to be highs in the mid-50s all weekend. Coldest day being Sunday.
I guess that's all relative to some of these teams who have those northern roots.
That is true.
Pennsylvania and in upstate New York.
3-2. Ring him up. Got him looking. Called strike three. It's a look-em strikeout for Dylan Hayduke as Casiro picks up a punch out. That'll send things to Tony Rossi, the third baseman.
I remember last year, I think it was a game with Rochester and Piedmont, and they had to, it was a game cut short due to weather, but those fans were braving it out in about 40-degree weather, and it was raining, misting sideways, and not ideal, but I guess it's better than snow.
0-1, hacked at a miss, 0-2. 0-2 count, two outs, top of the fifth inning. Casiro's come in and looked sharp so far. So he'll set now on the mound. Deep breath, pitch delivered. Low and outside, it's 1-2. And tomorrow, two more games. And Sunday, two more games. tonight being the final game of action for today here at Atrium Health Ballpark, as this one's fouled off.
Yeah, so if anybody in the area is looking for some weekend plans, you want to catch some early season ball. I know it's not the ballers, but some great local or high college talent out here. And just come out and enjoy an afternoon at the ballpark tomorrow afternoon.
1-2 up and inside. Count is 2-2. Yeah, free admission all weekend. I'm sure you pop by and come hang out. Got concession options open as well. 2-2. Chop to third. Diving effort. He won't get there, though. And Rossi has a three-hit day. A two-out base hit for the third baseman, Rossi. And he is on. So now Jack Cahill will get another turn at the plate.
I know we were talking about a little bit earlier about the differences between this stadium and the old stadium. I think the biggest one that I've can notice is just the video capabilities here at the new ballpark.
Yes.
You know, being able to broadcast games on YouTube and MILB.TV for Cannonballers games.
Yeah, absolutely. Back at the old place, we had nothing in the form of video. It was all audio only. If you wanted to catch Intimidators games, and now in the new ballpark, all kinds of broadcast capability. Cahill has a 1-1 count. So it's certainly nice. Actually, one of the requirements coming to minor league baseball in 2025, so not this year, but next year, every minor league team will be required to have some sort of option for video, as runner takes off for second, and he's going to get there in time despite the pickoff attempt. So Rossi is going to get credit for a stolen base. He did take off, but Casero didn't motion to the plate. He opted to go to first, and Rossi outran him.
I think it'll be really a nice addition for, you know, some of those teams that have not had the capabilities to do that in the past, but you know, with that said, also there is an expense.
It is a very expensive operation, that's for sure.
Yeah.
All the video cameras and audio equipment and everything, because you can't really have a video stream without a broadcaster. 2-1 in the way. Swing and a miss, 2-2.
Yeah, I know there are some teams in even the Carolina League that were so kind of the traditional audio only this past season.
Yeah. 2-2 count, pitch delivered, runner going. Foul tip, headed back to the net.
Looks like they had some sort of hit and run on there.
Kind of a hit and run chance for Susquehanna, but it didn't work exactly.
Yeah, I think the Down East was the team I was referring to, thinking of the video.
Yeah, Down East does not have any broadcast of any kind. 2-2. In there, upstairs, ring him up, got him, looking cold. Strike three, Jack Cahill down on strikes. He's the third out, and that'll send us into the bottom half of the fifth inning here in Kannapolis. Still 4-2 Riverhawks. We'll take a quick break and be right back here in Kannapolis. From the D3 Showcase, it's Susquehanna and Rochester.
Welcome back to the Cannonballers YouTube Network here for the matchup tonight here in downtown Kannapolis as part of the D3 showcase between the Rochester Yellow Jackets and the Susquehanna University Riverhawks. First pitch swinging there to number 44, Dylan Stetsy, a graduate student there at the University of Rochester. Called strike two. Quickly 0-2 here. Wind in the pitch just a bit outside. For those watching on YouTube, feel free to send us comments, share the stream out to folks, and we can get more people watching and have this broadcast out to more families across the United States. Swing and a miss, pitch in the dirt, throw down, completes the strikeout, and we got one away here in the bottom of the fifth. Now batting for the Rochester Yellow Jackets, number 3, Joe Siciliano, catcher out of West Lafayette, Indiana, home of the Boilermakers. First pitch outside, ball one.
Joe Siciliano in at the plate for Rochester. 1-0 hacked and missed. 1-1 on the catcher for Rochester. Top of the order, Ethan Hockett waiting on deck. Pitch delivered in there. Ring him up, got him looking. Called a strike three. And Siciliano is down on strikes, a backwards K. And Redmond, tell you what, Walker, he's been looking sharp so far since allowing a couple extra early runs for Rochester.
Yeah, he's definitely settled in here to a bit of a rhythm after that, giving up runs in the first and second here.
First pitch to Hockhead is a bit low and outside, a 1-0 count. Four hits on the night for Rochester so far, and six for Susquehanna. 1-0. Hacked and missed. 1-1.
And there's that insurance that Redmond picked up there in the top of the fourth with the four spot.
1-1 in and out of the glove. 2-1. Jackson Reed, shortstop, awaits on deck as Hockhead at the plate, 0-2, with a ground out and a strikeout. 2-1. Upstairs, now 3-1. Ethan Hockhead from Bronxville, New York. 3-1. Lifted high and foul. Count now runs full. Two outs. Bottom of the fifth inning. Rochester looking to get back in this thing. Trailing 4-2. 3-2 pitch. Lifted high and foul again. Full count on Hockett. Center fielder for the Yellow Jackets. 3-2. Breaking ball outside. Cornering him up. Got him looking. Called strike three. Fire me up, Ryan Redmond. He's got another strikeout. Another 1-2-3 frame. He sat down his last seven in a row as Redmond. That'll send us to another 1-2-3 frame. To the sixth we go here in Kannapolis. 4-2. Susquehanna on top. Lance Book leads it off for the Susquehanna Riverhawks here in top of the sixth inning of tonight's action as Susquehanna on top, sitting pretty. 4-2 is your score as the breaking ball from Casero is a bit low. Casero back out there on the bump. Another inning of action for the Rochester Jackets. This one's lifted high down the line and right, hooking. It'll land foul.
Just outside play.
1-1 your count. Lance Book.
Looks like we got a kids run after that baseball.
Lance Book 0 for 2 tonight with a ground out and a strikeout. Here's the pitch from Casero. This one's roped into left field. That'll drop for a base knock for Lance Book. His first hit of the day. Just in front of the left fielder in Stezzi for a base hit to lead things off. Michael Mancuso will stand in for Susquehanna.
Some of these guys on Susquehanna are starting to become regulars here, making the annual trek down. I think this might be their second or third appearance here at the D3 Showcase in downtown Kannapolis.
I know Rochester was here last year. I know Susquehanna was here last year. This one was inside to Mancuso, ball one.
I always thought it might be kind of cool if they, handed out a piece of hardware at the end of the weekend.
Yeah, still need to get on that. As this one's grounded to third, second for one on to first, and it's a double play on ice. 5-4-3 double play. Mancuso grounds into this one, and that does make it now nobody on and two outs for Thomas Romanelli. As just like that, Susquehanna went from starting to cook something up to now just a standard inning of what could be 1-2-3 baseball.
Yeah, I was thinking maybe a continuing on that thought, maybe a piece of hardware for the most outstanding player of the weekend.
Most outstanding player or team with the best overall record. Maybe Matt Millward, our general manager, will hear this and hear our recommendation that some of that put in the budget for next year. 1-0. Bit outside, 2-0 count.
No,
get some hardware. You got to give some hardware out for these things.
I mean, I'm not too much of a fan of the participation trophies or anything, but, just have a nice little keepsake from
I wouldn't call it a participation trophy. That was a strike. So 2-1 your count on Romanelli. I don't think it'd be a participation trophy by any means. You end up with the best record in the weekend. Be something to be proud of. 2-1 in there. Called strike on Romanelli. 2-2 your count. Romanelli, a bases clearing RBI triple last time he stepped to the plate. He's got a 2-2 count here against the lefty Matt Casero. 2-2. Weaved at and missed. Catcher dropped the third strike. It'll be a K2-3, though, as he finishes the play. And just like that, it's an unconventional 1-2-3 frame. They do get a hit to Susquehanna, but it is thwarted, as we'll send things into the bottom of the sixth. We'll be right back after a quick break here in Kannapolis. Bottom of the sixth we go here in Kannapolis as Rochester will step in. It'll be Jackson Reed, Sammy Bestry, and Josh Leadham to step to the plate here in this bottom of the sixth inning. And in that inning break, I learned something, and I got to have some talks with some higher-ups. As this one's chopped to third, hot corner played well by the third baseman Rossi. Across the first he goes. One pitch, one out, a 5-3 ground out. One out had. As now Sammy Bestry will step in. So the Kannapolis Cannonballers have a home game against the Salem Red Sox on August the 3rd. Well, on the same day, just down the road in Columbia, there is a rather large happening going on. First pitch in there, a called strike, 0-1 on Bestry. Myself, Dan Helody, broadcaster for the Cannonballers. Of course, I love more than baseball. 0-1 tapped fair down the third base side. Rossi makes the play. Across he goes, and it's two ground outs to the third baseman. So two outs now. Josh Leadham is going to step in. Leadham had an RBI triple in the first, and he struck out looking in his last at-bat in the third.
Very quick. Redmond making very quick work of the Yellow Jackets right now. I think
Redmond's been looking sharp. Gave up a few runs early, but he has settled in, and he has looked superb, as the old broadcaster's curse happens. 1-0 count as Josh Leadham steps in. August 3rd, I just found out that Manchester United is playing Liverpool. 1-0 count, and there for a called strike, 1-1. You want to talk about a rivalry?
Yes, that is.
That there may not be a bigger rivalry. 1-1, this one's low. It's now 2-1 is your count. I would say Man United-Liverpool would be the same level of rivalry in soccer as UNC-Duke basketball. Two-one, a bit low and outside. 3-1 on Josh Leadham. On deck awaiting is Henry Jameson. University of Rochester. Coached in the Cape Cod League a few years ago for the Bourne Braves. As 3-1 is low and outside for ball four. It'll be a two-out free pass issue to Josh Leadham. So one on now for Rochester with two outs.
First guy to reach in a couple innings.
Henry Jameson will step in, as that's the first base runner Rochester's had since the third inning. It's been a while since Rochester's had someone on base. Runner going on the first pitch. This one is a bit outside of the plate. Throw it a second. Didn't they get him? No. A stolen base for Josh Leadham. Someone just commented in a private message to me. Alabama and Auburn football. That's a pretty big rivalry.
That is a pretty big one.
That's a big one.
The Iron Bowl, I believe.
Iron Bowl. South Carolina Clemson's always a fun one. 1-0, outside corner, called strike. Florida and Florida State. Of course, me being from Florida, that's a rivalry. What's the best rivalry? We're going to talk about this now. What's the best rivalry in sports?
In sports, collegiate, I guess.
As the 1-1 count in there, 1-2 your count on Jameson.
It might be a little bias here. Oklahoma, Texas as a alumnus.
That's a good one. That's
a
really good one.
Of Oklahoma. Definitely don't like, they say don't mess with Texas, but as an Oklahoma guy, definitely don't really mess with.
You got a little bias.
Yeah, I might have a little bias, but.
You got a little bias in that one, Walker. Walker Brook, a graduate of the University of Oklahoma. 1-2. Jameson's going to have to wait as Redmond will check on the runner at second. It is Leadham.
There's Oklahoma, Oklahoma State.
Oklahoma, Oklahoma State's a good one.
Call that Bedlam.
Are there any good minor league baseball rivalries?
You know,
I'm thinking of one kind of in this area. I would say Charlotte and Durham are a bit of a rivalry. 1-2. This one is lined through. That's going to get into center for a base knock. Leadham's going to score on the play. There will be the throw in, but it won't be in time, and it's off the mark. An RBI single for Henry Jameson. That'll score Leadham, and Rochester, just like that, is back in this ballgame. It's a one-run game, 4-3, your score. With two outs in this bottom of the sixth inning, and Alexander Gonzalo is going to get another chance to bat. So yeah. Gonzalo had a solo homer in the second inning, and then he struck out in the fourth. But with one swing of the bat, he could tie it or give Rochester the lead. First pitch, lifted high and foul, 0-1. I think we opened up a can of worms, because I'm now getting absolutely blasted with text messages and just messages in general of best rivalries.
Best minor league baseball rivalry.
Is there a good minor league baseball rivalry? There's got to be.
I think of
0-1, runner going. It's outside of the plate. Throw in a second is not in time. It's a stolen base for Jameson. So two outs and a runner now in scoring position. It is the tying run. Of course, I'm biased, but me being a Dolphins guy, Dolphins have still a pretty strong rivalry with the Buffalo Bills. Here's a pitch from Redmond to Gonzalo. Swing and a miss at the plate. It's a strikeout as Gonzalo goes flailing at that off-speed pitch. And that is strike three. So there's the completion of six innings of baseball. Headed to the back third of baseball here at the D3 Showcase. We'll talk about more of our famous and favorite rivalries in the top of the seventh when we come back here in Kannapolis. It is 4-3 Susquehanna over Rochester. Top of the seventh we go here at Atrium Health Ballpark. Chris Orego steps in against Matt Casero. First pitch is a bit inside, a 1-0 count. Now on the Riverhawks catcher, it's Orego, Biuso, and McCulloch stepping in. We're getting some help with some minor league baseball rivalries from our general manager, Matt Millward, who has joined us. He's just not on air. Pitch inside a 2-0 count. He says Lehigh Valley and Scranton-Wilkes-Barre is heated. I could see that. Buffalo and Rochester, I'd also imagine. 2-0 pitch. Tapped foul. 2-1 your count.
Buffalo and Syracuse?
Buffalo and, I would say Buffalo and Rochester probably.
Rochester.
More. Just geographically. I could see Buffalo and Syracuse being a little bit, though. 2-1. Wave and a miss. 2-2 your count.
Bison, I believe. Mm-hmm. Buffalo?
Buffalo Bisons.
Triple A.
Triple A for the Toronto Blue Jays. And the Rochester Red Wings, 2-2 fouled off by Rego. Rochester Red Wings are the AAA affiliate of the Washington Nationals. They were with the Minnesota Twins for a long time. And then they went back to the Nationals affiliate. 2-2 pitch, up and away. Count is now full. Walker Brook trivia question. What West Coast AAA team was the AAA affiliate of the Washington Nationals about 5 years ago?
5 years ago.
3-2. Tapped foul ball.
AAA. I'm going to say Fresno Grizzlies.
You are correct.
Yeah, wasn't too confident on that.
Fresno was a AAA affiliate for a long time. 3-2. So we got a foul tip.
Almost knocked his hat off there.
It was indeed the Fresno Grizzlies. New York Mets also moved around. They had the Las Vegas 51s for a little bit. And then they moved to Syracuse. 3-2. This one is grounded to third. Played and muffed by Jameson initially, but he picks it up and throws to first, and it is in time for the out. A 5-3 ground out now, and Arrego is retired. So one down and Biasso will get another turn.
Always kind of like that Las Vegas 51s.
Yeah, the Vegas 51s were cool.
Now I think they got the aviators out there.
Of course, you got the Albuquerque Isotopes, named after a Simpsons reference. They had a hill in center field for a long time, did the Isotopes. They had a full-blown hill. It's already hard enough to hit out there in Albuquerque. Pitch in there to Busso for a called strike, 0-1.
Kind of like the hill they had, I should say, in Houston for a little bit.
Had Towles Hill.
Mm-hmm.
0-1. This one's lifted into right center. That's going to fall and be trouble. Might be extra bases for Busso. Finally picking it up, and right is Leadham. He's going to have to throw it in, but chugging for third is Busso. Play at third is not in time, and it's a triple for Michael Busso. It'll be a triple for the nine-hole batter for Susquehanna. A one-out three-bagger, and now top of the order, Sean McCulloch for the Riverhawks. There was a point in time, I honestly think even today, where if you gave me a Major League Baseball team and the level of Minor League Baseball, I could probably, I'm pretty confident in my ability, I could tell you who the current affiliate is.
Oh, now you've got me thinking now. Might need to quiz you. You asked me a trivia question.
That's fine by me. Pitch upstairs. It's ball one. On a Sean McCulloch, leadoff batter. A walk, a strikeout, and a flyout on his night. Caseros 1-0. Fastball upstairs part of the zone, 1-1.
What minor league team is closest to Susquehanna?
What minor league team is closest to Susquehanna? I feel like I've already said them tonight. 1-1 up and away. It's the Harrisburg Senators, double A, for the Washington Nationals. It had to have been, I was thinking out loud, it could have been either Harrisburg or it was Lehigh Valley or Scranton. I thought it was something in that range. 2-1 is a bit outside, 3-1 your count. I'll tell you what I love doing. When I go on road trips, I love stopping in Carlisle and my drives up there in that area because they have the giant Flint Lindor chocolate factory outlet store where you can go take a bag and you fill them with all those Lindt truffles, and it's like a flat rate per pound that you get those chocolate truffles. Those are dangerous. I'm a big fan of Lindor truffles. 3-2 to McCullough. Just a bit outside for ball four. He'll reach base for the second time today via the free pass. So now runners on the corners. Dylan Hayduke will step in for the Riverhawks. So now we have action going in the pen for Rochester. It might be a pitching change coming as Casero has been in there for quite a bit. See if there is indeed a pitching change as Rochester looking for a spark somehow to try to stay in this ball game, as certainly Susquehanna has been threatening.
Thinking of other minor league teams in Pennsylvania with Altoona Curve.
Altoona Curve would be double A for the Pittsburgh Pirates.
Yep.
Paul Skeens pitched there. Of course, number one pick for the Pittsburgh Pirates in the most recent draft.
Yeah, I think they was actually talking to their general manager at the fall meetings in Las Vegas this fall. And he was saying it was their largest crowd in ballpark history. And he came in and threw about less than an inning, and that was that. He got roughed up there. But
yeah, Skeens was roughed up in the inning. I remember watching that. I think every person who cares about baseball prospects was keeping an eye on that one. 1-0 upstairs. It's now a 1-1 count on Hayduke. Runners on second and third. A stolen base from McCulloch. 1-1. Grounded to second. Backhanded by the second baseman. Played the plate and throws not in time. It'll be a fielder's choice that allows Hayduke to reach, as the play at the plate is not in time. So scoring is Busso, and McCulloch is going to reach. So a fielder's choice gives the Riverhawks another run. It is now 5-3. It is not a hit, but it is another run to cross the plate, as now it looks like Rochester is going to make a move to the bullpen. I'll take a break and be right back here, as we'll get you all the details of the new arm when we come back here in Kannapolis. Righty pitcher Thomas Blades takes over for the Rochester Yellow Jackets here. Top of the seventh as first pitch to Rossi, blooped into shallow center. Backtracking and making the catch is the shortstop. Play at the plate is not in time, so the runner will score. It is McCullough. It'll be a sacrifice, basically, as Rossi pops out into shallow center to the shortstop. So two outs now, but scoring on the play is McCullough.
Nice little play out there.
So Cahill will step in. A sacrifice pop out. How often do you see that?
Once in a blue moon?
Not very often. Jack Cahill will step in. As Thomas Blades takes over, pitch delivered. Inside. Count is now 1-0. Final line for Matt Casero, still in the works. Two and a third, three hits, a walk, and three punch outs. Still is responsible for the runner on base at first and is diving back in. Not in time to try to get Haydu. Cahill at the plate. Strikeout, a single, and a looking strikeout. Susquehanna still working with the same arm in Ryan Redmond. 1-0 pitch. Upstairs, 2-0. Check on the runner at first. Is not in time. Count is 2-0 still on Cahill. Lehigh Valley Iron Pigs in Allentown, Pennsylvania. Not too far at all. Pitch is foul off. 2-1.
Bacon USA, I think is what they call it out there.
Bacon USA. They have those jerseys that say Bacon USA. Automatically, you got to love it more. Everything's better with bacon. Don't listen to the people who say the bacon is bad. 2-1. Foul off. 2-2 your count. Bacon is amazing. It's not a necessity for everything. I think people sometimes can go overboard with the bacon. Example, I don't need bacon and ice cream. That's a little weird. 2-2. In there, ring him up, got him looking, called strike three. Thomas Blades picks up a strikeout. Jack Cahill is looking here at strike three. So that's the third out, and that'll send us to the stretch here in Kannapolis. 6-3, Susquehanna on top. They add a couple of insurance runs that'll send us to a break. We'll be right back here. Here in Kannapolis, 6-3, Susquehanna Riverhawks on top. Dan Tirabassi leads it off. Bottom of the seventh, 6-3 your score. Susquehanna over Rochester. Pitch delivered from Ryan Redmond. Still on the mound, his seventh inning of work. As this is first pitch is outside for a ball. 1-0 your count on Tirabassi. Pitch on the way is lifted high and foul. 1-1 your count on Tirabassi.
Getting down into the final few ABs here for the Yellow Jackets. Going to need to start cooking up some offense.
1-1 outside corner. Called a strike.
One-two pitch on the way. Just a bit high.
Just a bit outside to Tirabassi. Last year, Redmond's high. He went 6 2/3 in a game last year, which is his career high. So he is two outs away from tying his career high in a longest outing. 2-2. Just a bit upstairs. Check swing. Did he go? No. Count will run full on Dan Tirabassi.
We got some action down in the River Hawks bullpen.
Stezzi and Siciliano waiting on a deck. 3-2 to Tirabassi. Just a bit outside from all four. And now Rochester puts a runner on with a free pass. So one on, nobody out. And due up is Dylan Stezzi.
Looks like we've got a visit coming.
Now time called. And looks like Ryan Redmond's day is done. Looks like he will be removed from this one, and we will have a new pitcher on the bump for Susquehanna, but it is a sharp, sharp outing from the righty. Looks like he's trying to talk them into letting him stay out there. I don't think it's going to work, though, as it just may work, though. It may have worked. Looks like they're going to let him stay in the game. So Redmond is still on the bump.
I think he said, all right, coach, I got this. One pitch, two outs.
Stezzi steps in. First pitch hacked it and missed. It worked. And he's back in still. Strike one. And appreciate everyone tuning in and hanging out with us. This one is in there, 0-2. Count. Pitch to Stezzi. In and out of the glove of the catcher in Orego. And this one's to the backstop. It is a ball. And moving to second on the passed ball is the runner in Tirabassi. So it is a passed ball. It's been out of the glove, and he definitely could have made the catch. So a 1-2 count. Siciliano now waiting on deck for Rochester. Pitch delivered. Grounded sharply to second. Diving effort. He won't be able to get there. It's through and to right for a base hit. Rounding third and headed back to third. It'll be the lead runner. And into second on the throw is going to be Stezzi. So he'll get credit for the single. And then he advances on the throw. So it is a single. And he advances on the throw to second. It's not an error by any means. But it is 2-1. For the Yellow Jackets, and that'll conclude the night for Ryan Redmond. We'll take a quick break. We'll step aside, get you the details on the new arm, and we come back here in Kannapolis. Susquehanna going to the bullpen for the first time tonight.
Welcome back to the Cannonballers YouTube Network here as the Division 3 showcase rolls on here at Atrium Health Ballpark in downtown Kannapolis. We've got a 6-3 advantage for the Riverhawks over the Rochester Yellow Jackets. We got a new pitcher on the bump now, number 35, Tegan Duffy for the Riverhawks.
Now Duffy in on the mound. First pitch delivered to Siciliano, a bit low and inside, a 1-0 count. Tegan Duffy on the bump, 6'1", 200-pound lefty from Douglasville, Pennsylvania. Daniel Boone Area High School, majoring in Political Science and International Studies at Susquehanna. As the 1-0 is tapped, a second diving effort at second, play made, throw to first in time for the out, but another run crosses the plate this time for Rochester. Tirabassi will get the run to score as Siciliano drives it in, a 4-3 ground out, an RBI ground out. So Rochester cuts it to now 6-4, and top of the order, Ethan Hockett's going to stand in.
Rochester looking to get that second run back that they gave up in the top of the seventh.
So Hockett waves and misses. It is a 0-1 count. Run is charged to Redmond, who can allow a max at the most of 5 runs. Pitch is a bit outside, a 1-1 count. He's at 4 runs allowed now in his outing. 6 innings, 6 hits, 3 walks, 8 punchouts in 23 batters faced for Ryan Redmond. A nice night, 1-1. Bit inside from Duffy. It is a 2-1 count. Tegan Duffy, definitely a guy who can go deep into games. Career high of 7 1/3 innings pitched back in 2022 against my mom's old alma mater, Moravian. Pitch inside, 3-1 your count. Moravian in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. My mom went to Moravian. And Matt Millward is from Bethlehem. 3-1 up and inside. Ethan Hockett will take the free pass. So the walk issued. Now runners on first and third. So now the go-ahead run's going to step to the plate. It's Jackson Reed.
The runners on the corners here.
First pitch to Reed is inside. Running for second is Hockett, and he'll get there easily. It's a stolen base. So now runners on third and second. So now one base hit for Rochester, and it would tie the game. Corners playing in. 1-0 pitch. Up and in, 2-0 to Jackson Reed. Reed today, a fly out, a single, and a ground out. 2-0. This one's lifted into left center field. That's going to drop and roll all the way into the wall. That'll be at least one run scored. Two runs will score. Here comes Reed headed for third. Play at third is not going to be even close. And it's a stand-up RBI triple to tie the ball game for Rochester. Jackson Reed with a triple. And that scores 2 more runs. 6-6 is your score now. And Stezzy and Hockett both cross the plate on Jackson Reed's 2 RBI triple.
Redmond there was dealing for a little bit and then just ran into a little bit of trouble here in the seventh, and now we've got a brand new ball game all tied up at 6 apiece.
And now the infield's going to play in as this one's tapped foul by Bestry. It'll be a 0-1 count. So Redmond's line is complete. 5 runs all earned. And one of these runs is charged to Duffy. So five of them are Redmonds, and one of them is Duffy's. How about a second one, though? Is this one is in and out of the glove of the catcher, and it gets to the backstop, and Rochester has taken the lead now with a four-run bottom of the seventh inning on a passed ball again by the catcher in Orego. He gets the allows the ball across on a passed ball, second one of the night. And now Rochester is taking a 7-6 lead. 1-1 from Duffy. This one's inside. And Bestry with a 2-1 count.
A little bit of trying to just find that strike zone, Dan.
It's become mayhem here in Kannapolis between Rochester and Susquehanna. Two-one count. Duffy's pitch, bit up and away. As it's now 3-1 on Sammy Bestry. Three-one, fouled off, straight back. Count will now run full. Three-two count, one out. Bottom of the seventh inning. Pitch delivered, swing and a miss at the plate. Tegan Duffy picks up a strikeout. Sammy Bestry is down on strikes. That's the second out. He is now 1-for-3. Josh Leadham now steps in for Rochester. First pitch to Leadham, a bit up and away, a 1-0 count. Leadham had that big RBI triple in the first inning to get Rochester on the board. 1-0 pitch. In there on the inside corner, 1-1. As right now, should results hold and there not be a lead change, it would be Duffy on the mound getting the loss. Pitches in there, 1-2 on Leadham. It would be Blades right now getting the win. 1-2, grounded a short, playable, and comes in, makes the play, in and out of the glove though, and it is going to be a base hit as he would have been able to run that out. Made the effort, but it was going to be one that he was able to run out. So Leadham gets a single in the infield. Henry Jameson is going to step in. 1-for-3 now on the night.
Riverhawks here just trying to stop the bleeding. Came in with a couple-run lead and evaporated.
As Jameson puts a charge into this ball into left field. Backtracking, though, is the left fielder in Cahill. He makes the grab for the out, and that does stop for the time being the offensive role for Rochester. But they come back four runs in this bottom half of the frame, and it's a big lead now for Rochester. 7-6, your score. We'll be right back. Top of the eighth, we come back. The Yellow Jackets now six outs away from victory. Lance Book leads it off for the Susquehanna Riverhawks. Top of the eighth inning is now Rochester, 6 outs away from clinching victory. Thomas Blades back on the mound as Lance Book puts a charge into this ball into center, but well tracking it out in center is Hockett. He makes the snag for the out, and just like that, it is a F8 into center and makes it 5 outs remaining in Susquehanna's night. Unless they can put some offense together. Michael Mancuso is going to step in. He was hit by a pitch in the fourth and ended up scoring later in the inning. Other than that, a strikeout and a ground into a double play. Breaking ball from Blades in there called strike. It's 0-1.
Only one swing of the bat, though. Still a one-run game here.
Yeah, our first pitch of tonight was at 7:33. So it's been a well-paced ball game. Pitch in there, 0-2 your count. Now on Michael Mancuso. First game tonight was 2 hours and 27 minutes on the dot. So we're about to eclipse that mark here in Kannapolis in this game 2 of today's action. 0-2 fouled off by Mancuso. There is another arm warming for Rochester down the line in right. As time called, ball gets loose.
What are your thoughts about the bullpens down the lines versus the, you know, old school? I don't know if it's old school is the right word to say, but it's old bullpens out in, you know, the outfield at those major league parks and stuff.
I think either way, as long as it's executed in a sharp manner. 0-2 grounded to second. Played and thrown to first for the out. A 4-3 ground out. I think either way, it has functionality. Obviously, safety concerns with bullpens being on the field and in the field of play. That being said, it certainly cuts down some of the time from the run out from the outfield all the way back into the pitcher's mound. It cuts some of that time down, so just like anything, there's good and there's bad. Nothing is ever perfect in today's philosophy lesson with Dan Helody. First pitch hacked at and missed. It is 0-1 on Thomas Romanelli.
I think a cool thing that we could, not really practical with the bullpens down the line here at Atrium Health Ballpark, but definitely the return of the bullpen cart. I know some teams are starting to bring those things back.
Bullpen carts certainly are awesome. I think the Washington Nationals have one. I know the Nationals were one of the teams that brought it back pretty recently. I think Sean Doolittle was behind that one. 0-2 count. Two outs. Top of the eighth inning. Thomas Romanelli at the plate. Pitch delivered in the dirt. Blocked by the catcher in Siciliano. Romanelli had a big bases clearing RBI triple back in the fourth inning. We've seen a few of those tonight. One-two count with two outs. Pitch delivered. Swung on, lifted into center field. Should be playable for the center fielder in Hockett. Indeed, he does make the play. And just like that, Rochester, 3 outs away from victory. They'll look to add some insurance runs in the bottom of the eighth inning. We'll take a peek at what they can do when they come back here in Kannapolis. We'll be right back after this short break. Alexander Gonzalo steps in and leads it off here for the Rochester Yellow Jackets. He check swings on the first pitch and goes around on it. 0-1 your count here. New arm on the mound for the Susquehanna Riverhawks is Bryce Gregory, taking over after an inning of work from Tegan Duffy that unfortunately saw them surrender four runs to Rochester. This one's lifted high into foul ground, and it'll end up at the seats. 0-2 count. So Gonzalo, Tirabassi, and Stezzi do up here in this bottom of the eighth inning. Rochester on top, 7-6. As Gonzalo had a home run back in the second, but he struck out twice since that. Approaching 10 o'clock here on the East Coast. 0-2 to Gonzalo. Lifted foul. It'll end up in the seating level here in the suites. As it'll be a souvenir for whoever ends up there next. 0-2 count on Gonzalo. And that solo homer and then two swinging strikeouts right after that. Pitch delivered. Gets a piece of that one. He'll stay alive. Bryce Gregory, 6-foot senior from Abingdon, Maryland. Career high, 5 innings pitched back in 2021 against Moravian. Oh! Pitch delivered. He gets a piece of this one. It's lifted high and foul.
Just trying to put a charge into that one again.
Oh, 2. Low and outside. A good high from Gonzalo. Pitch delivered on the 1-2. This one is skied high into foul ground. First baseman after it. It is Book. He makes the grab for the out. It is just like that. A P3 for Gonzalo. And Tirabassi will step in. Is a pinch hitter for Rochester. Looks like Quincy Yox will step in for Rochester as Yox will look at ball one. Quincy Yox will pinch hit here for Rochester. 1-0. Low and outside from Bryce Gregory. It is 2-0.
Fouled off.
This one's fouled off. 2-1 your count. Final line for Tegan Duffy. One inning, two hits, two runs. As Yox swings and misses, 2-2. Six batters faced. Two runs, a walk, and a strikeout for Tegan Duffy for Susquehanna. 2-2 is skied, and it's a pop-up in the infield. Who's got it? Gregory is going to be called off. Third baseman and makes the muff in the infield, and it's going to be a base hit. It has to be a base hit as it will fall in the infield. Tony Rossi, it was an I got it, I got it, you got it, and it has to be a base hit in that scenario. It's not a incapability to make the play, and you can't call a mental lapse an error. So it's a pop-up in the infield. It's an I got it, I got it, you got it. So it is considered a base hit. Stezzi will step in, first pitch in the dirt. So Yox gets on base with what is an infield single.
Yeah, I was going to say all the these different stadiums that you go to out throughout the course of the season and stuff, all being young, you just got to learn the lighting.
Absolutely. A bit of a tough scenario, too, with Gregory trying to make a play on the ball as this one's in there for a called strike, 1-1 on Stezzy. Yeah, that scenario, you might think it's an error, just with it being a ball that, I mean, come on, he should have got a pop out. But in that scenario, when you had a bunch of people kind of trying to get in the mix on that play, and again, it specifically says in the rule book, you cannot use a mental lapse of judgment as an error. As this one's lifted into foul ground, Rossi will make the play for the out. It's a pop out for Stezzy. He makes the play there. So a P5, two outs, and Joe Siciliano will step in.
You know, some of the older stadiums used to not have even lights. They all just played some day ball.
Yeah, the last ballpark in the major leagues to get lights, Wrigley Field. It's still a reason why they play so many day games. Because Wrigley Field didn't have lights for a long time. The Cubs were extremely anti-night game. I still don't know. I don't know about you. I'm a big night game guy.
Yeah, it doesn't really bother me one way or the other. I'll go out and the North Carolina summers are on the bit of a warmer side. But don't mind a day game. You know, growing up, I used to go with my father out to Pirates games up in Pittsburgh on Sunday afternoons after church and everything like that. But I know some of the smaller schools, you know, there is an expense with the lighting and everything too. So a lot of schools just opt for the day games, the early, you know, afternoon games and stuff. And
pitch on the way from Gregory. Fastball upstairs to Siciliano. 1-2 your count. I don't know. Growing up in Tampa, going to Tampa Bay Rays games, every game was under the lights. Didn't matter. Night game, day game, didn't matter. 1-2. Outside corner, ring him up, got him looking, called strike three. Siciliano is down looking at strike three. So Bryce Gregory picks up a nice little inning of work. He gets the pop out to Gonzalo, pop out for Stezzy. He allows that single from Yox, but quickly rebounds and picks up the strikeout of Siciliano. To the ninth we go. Rochester, three outs away from victory. We'll see if they can hold on when we come back here in Kannapolis. Pinch hitter for Susquehanna here in this top of the ninth inning. Thomas Anderson is going to get a chance to bat here in place of Chris Orego against Thomas Blades, still on the mound for Rochester. First pitch on the way, top of the ninth, is in there, called strike. Again, Rochester three outs away from picking up the victory here in Kannapolis. A one count on Thomas Anderson. Here is the pitch. Just a bit inside, 1-1.
There's always these pressure situations late in games where up by one run, call on your pitcher to close it out and see what happens here.
1-1 count on Anderson. Pitch delivered outside. Count moves to 2-1. Thomas Anderson, Jr. from Wontog, New York. I definitely butchered that. 2-1 count. Pitch from Blades. Swung on and fouled back. It is a 2-2 count. Blades in line for the victory. The loss would go to Tegan Duffy should the game end right now. Two-two count, Blades on the bump. If another pitcher comes in for Rochester, they would be in line for the save. 2-2, swinging a miss at the plate. He struck him out. Another punch out for Thomas Blades. Thomas Anderson is down on strikes, and now two outs away from victory are the Rochester Yellow Jackets. Stepping in is going to be Michael Busso, who is 1-for-3 today with a bases-clearing RBI triple.
I think we do have a Rochester pitcher down there. Again, loose just in case someone were to get on base.
Pitch a bit upstairs and away, a 1-0 count on Michael Busso, who's got three RBI tonight. Excuse me, he does not have three RBI. He does have a triple. 1-0 on the way. Breaking ball just a bit upstairs. Count is 2-0. Top of the order in Sean McCulloch. Blades is 2-0. In and out of the glove of the catcher in Siciliano. Count is 3-0 on Michael Busso. Rochester looking to pick up a victory in their first game of the season. 3-0 pitch. Fastball in there, a called strike on the outside corner. It's 3-1. Thomas Blades, who's looked sharp since entering in relief of Matt Casero. 3-1 count, pitch delivered. Another fastball right down Broadway, called strike, 3-2. Full count, one down. Busso trying to reach base as the tying run. Go-ahead run is on deck. Payoff pitch on the way. Swing and a miss at the plate. He struck him out. Another punch out for Thomas Blades. And Michael Busso is down on strikes. Two punch outs now in this top of the ninth inning. And Sean McCullough is going to stand in as the last hope and last effort for Susquehanna. McCullough, a walk, a strikeout, a fly out, and a walk. He's been a busy man tonight. Two outs, pitch delivered. Inside corner for strike one, it's 0-1. Thomas Blades trying to wrap this thing up. Glove of the belt, 0-1 on the way. Wave and a miss. And now Susquehanna is down to their final strike. The Riverhawks jumped out to a 4-2 lead after four innings. Gained some insurance, and then Rochester came storming back with a four-run bottom of the seventh inning. Blades will set, 0-2 count. Here's the pitch. Just a bit low, it's 1-2 on Sean McCullough. There is an arm warming for Rochester as a safety net. If Blades is unable to finish up this at-bat with McCullough. 1-2 count. Here's the pitch. Swung on a grounder towards second. Playable for Vestry. To first he goes, and Rochester claims victory in their first game of the season. Finishes up tonight's game at 10:09 here in Kannapolis. So that does it for Game 3 of the D3 Showcase, Game 2 of tonight's action here in Kannapolis, as Rochester comes back with a four-run bottom of the seventh inning and claims victory over the Susquehanna Riverhawks. Walker Brook, any final thoughts before we send our folks on our way tonight?
I appreciate you letting me hop on the air this evening and give me a chance to call some baseball with you. It's always great, whether it's Ballers baseball or whether it's D3 baseball.
Absolutely.
It's always a pleasure, and looking forward to another couple fun days here at the ballpark. Tomorrow we got games at 1 and 4:30, and then on Sunday we have games at 9 and 1 o'clock to wrap it out. So
looking forward to it for sure. Hope to have you join us on YouTube. Hopefully we'll see you real soon here out at Atrium Health Ballpark. For Walker Brook, for Matt Millward, I'm Dan Helody, saying thank you as always for tuning in. I'll leave you as I always do. Speak in love, love baseball, stay blessed. And until next time, here on YouTube on the Ballers Broadcast Network, we will see you next time. Final score tonight, Rochester 7 and Susquehanna 6. Enjoy the rest of your Friday night. Have a blessed one, and we will see you tomorrow for Day 3 of the 2024 D3 Showcase. Have a great one, everyone.